Germany and England and caused pain around the world. Is this a failure of globalization? Well, I think we find that the institutions and the laws that are designed to protect globalization are not in place. And there are some big lessons here for countries that are large and small. When you're a big country like the United States or China, these challenges are difficult to handle. They're politically difficult. But when you're a smaller country like Canada, or I suppose take Belgium, or take France, or Italy, it's very hard to really go astray, because you don't have the wherewithal to support an economy that becomes seriously troubled. Whereas, if you look at it, the United States, as a large country, has been running balance of payments deficits. People have been consuming beyond their ability. They have been using the mortgage value of their homes to consume. So you've got a large country that is living beyond its means. Small countries can't do that. Canada cannot live beyond its means. And hence, we have to take much more rigorous policy. And in fact, that will be the challenge for the government to weave its way through a stability pact and also trying to manage needs to essentially borrow money in US dollars, euros, Japanese yen, and other currencies. The Americans, by and large, go into debt in US dollars, and the rest of the world takes it. And this is indeed one of the things that presents a challenge to China, which is one of the biggest owners of US government debt. So, let me not belabor this, but globalization is under threat. It's a challenge. But if globalization fails, we'll all be worse off. Now, that's a pretty ugly picture, right? But there's good news, a little bit of good news. And a little bit of good news is that the academic world has studied the Great Depression of the 1930s. And a lot of work has gone on to try and understand the complexities. And this is why the first line of defense of governments was to shore up the banking systems. So in the 30s, when things got ugly, the United States in particular, I think, had 3,000 at least to 4,000 banks that failed. When they failed, people lost their wealth, and then you had a ricocheting effect through the economy. And then banks in Europe failed and elsewhere. So the governments this time have learned from the Depression, and they're trying to make sure that wealth is not further dissipated or destroyed through bank failures. But there's another point that differs from the 1930s. Two points. One, in the 1930s, they didn't know what hit them. Badly managed, no framework of analysis. And in fact, it took probably 7 or 8 years for a framework of analysis to be developed and people to start to think about the Depression. We have a framework of analysis. It may not be perfect, but at least there's a way of thinking about it. And secondly, in the 1930s, there was no data. People were flying blind. A lot of GNP and industrial statistics, financial statistics, either didn't exist or weren't very good, or weren't current. Today, one of the things that's characterized this crisis is the large amount of information. So, let me do three things, and I'll try and be brief. We had a world created by bubbles and a lack of reality. So what is reality? What is the economic reality that we have to face? Secondly, what are the big lessons for us as investors and financial people? And thirdly, how can we use this knowledge in the future? Well, first off, what is reasonable economic reality? Well, it's not like we've had in recent years. True economic reality is a high degree of uncertainty about government policy, macroeconomics, and financial policy environment. And similarly, without good understanding of what's happening to financial markets. Now think about what's happened in recent years. For most of the last 20 years, we had fairly stable environments. We had inflation coming down. We had governments pumping liquidity into the markets. And in fact, one of the reasons why the last 20 years was in fact not a bad time is that the governments had made horrible messes in the 1970s, creating a huge amount of inflation. So what we'd seen in the 80s and 90s was governments coming away from very serious policy mistakes in the late 60s, 1970s, And in my mind, they came to believe a number of false propositions. One, you saw economic leaders in at least two major countries I can think of, the United States and the United Kingdom, essentially saying that they had the great moderation. They had learned how to deal with a capitalist problem.